Well, good evening and welcome to our weekly Bible study. This is the book we're using, Max Lucado's Just Like Jesus devotional. So it's so good to have y'all with us. So why don't we begin with prayer? Most holy God, where two or three believers gather together, you promise that you will indeed be with us. Open our eyes this night to new truths as we meditate on your word. Grant us peace in the midst of our struggles and courage to press on, knowing that you always go before us, preparing the way. Use this time together to help our hearts get back on target. We pray in Jesus' most precious name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So we are on day 16 of the book, page 73. So the opening scripture is from Philippians 3. It says, I don't mean to say that I have already achieved these things or that I have already reached perfection, but I keep working toward that day when I will finally be all that Christ Jesus saved me for and wants me to be. So the title of this chapter is The Heart on Target. I'm just going to kind of summarize what he talked about so that we can all get back on the same page. He says, life is tough enough as it is. It's even tougher when we're headed in the wrong direction. One of the incredible abilities of Jesus was to stay on target. He never got off track. He kept his life on course. Then on page 74, he says, the heart of Christ was relentlessly focused on one task, and that is the cross of Calvary. Wouldn't you love to be able to do that same thing? Wouldn't you love to look back on your life and know that you had done what you were called to do? Our lives tend to be scattered, he writes. We are easily distracted by the small things and forget the big things. And then he tells, of course, this marvelous story about the sample aisle in the supermarket and about how the sausage lady, I think. Yeah, the sausage lady was ready and she had her plate extended, but he was interested in the celery, but she was just so preoccupied with making sure that everything on the plate looked good, but she was never, ever offering that celery to the people who might want one. So on page 75, he concludes by saying she was determined to get every celery stick just so on her plate, but she cared more about the appearance of her product than the distribution. The celery lady got off target. She was so occupied with the small matters that she forgot her actual assignment. So how do we keep from making the same mistake in life? God wants us to be just like Jesus and have focused hearts. So I think once again, this is such an easily relatable topic about getting our hearts off task. So the first question is what parts of life tend to distract your heart the most? That's a powerful question, huh? Okay, Chet, yes.
I would say my family, our finances, health and salvation. Hopefully salvation should be first of all.
Okay. Yeah. So what else tends to distract you the most? Yes, Jim.
With me, I think it's my health. You know, I can become very easily distracted and become anxious and worried when health issues arise instead of just trusting in God.
Okay. Yes, Linda.
Well, reading, but also in reading that, I realized I'm kind of like the celery lady. I spend a lot of my time straightening up and picking up instead of just sitting and talking to the people I'm with, especially the little ones. There's a lot of straightening up and I need to stop straightening and instead of being the celery lady, reach out like the sausage person.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Just to value the, you know, the people that are in your lives at that moment, to be present in the moment. Yes. Yes. Wayne, I think I saw your hand.
I said, you know, really oftentimes, particularly if you're a working person instead of having the luxury of being retired, but you know, your day-to-day tasks can very easily, if you're in a fast-paced work environment, get you totally off course because I've got this, and not focusing on what you need to do for your Christ, even in the workplace.
Yeah. Yeah. So sometimes when we have so many things going, we can't really give the needed attention to any of those, right? And so we do all of them poorly. You know, if you, Kathy and I always say that, you know, just do one thing at a time, because there's always lots of things going on. But if we just do one thing at a time and get that going, and then we can pass that project on to, you know, whoever needs to take over, then we can get to the other tasks rather than trying to focus on all of it at the same time. So, the other thing I wrote is that sometimes when we feel the need is too great, we start feeling helpless. You know, like the whole thing, you know, about Afghanistan, you know, that need is so great. And the Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Service, lifers, you know, they're working to help bring people from Afghanistan to the United States. And there's all these needs, you know, that churches can help out with, and you just don't know where to start. And so they say, well, just start out with the one thing that you can do. You know, maybe they're bringing a lot of the people to Fort Worth. And so maybe if you're close to Fort Worth, you can actually go and be, you know, in person, or, you know, maybe you can do a financial offering, or there's on their website, you can send an email to some of your representatives, you know, stating this is what you think we should be doing. And this is an organization, Lifers is an organization that's helping with that. And so they should find a way to partner with them. There's always something we can do rather than just saying, you know, it's too great. You know, the need is too great. I wouldn't know where to start. And so you do nothing. Sometimes just recognizing, you know, what can I do at this moment? Maybe there's a lot that I could ultimately do, but what can I do just in this moment? So that helps us, you know, from being distracted. Yes, Linda.
Is there a particular church in Fort Worth that's like adopting them?
Well, it's
that much.
Yeah, it's a lot of churches actually. It's the refugee service through the Lutheran Church is like partnering it, but it's lots and lots of churches. So maybe I can put, when we post this video, I can post the link to that site and you can go on and you can look at all of that, you know, where you can send an email. And the email is great because it comes up and it's kind of like a form letter, and you can just add, you know, your own thoughts to it. And you can say, you know, I'm from Texas and this is, you know, my county, and it'll get it to the right person. It's very easy to use. So, but yeah, there's a great group of people, and it's, yeah, they're doing in the Houston area. I think they're doing the Washington DC area. So, you know, our church is very active in this project, which is great. So, yeah. So I'll try to remember, Linda, to post the link in the notes of the and I can send it to you individually as well. So maybe you can take time to look at that. So,
okay, thank you.
So let's see, then it says, when God walks through your life, does he find you more like the celery lady or the sausage lady? You know, which one do we tend to be and why? Yes, Chet.
I would say the celery lady. I'm more interested in order of my surroundings, unfortunately.
Yes, yes. Anyone else? Yes, Jim.
I think I'm more like the sausage lady. I'm really eager to share my samples with other people.
Yeah, when you run out, you go get some more, huh? Okay. Yes, Wayne.
Yeah, I'm kind of in between at this point. I would have been more like Chet probably years ago and being the celery lady. And I still want things to be orderly. but I've really been forcing myself to be more like the sausage lady and get out there and talk to people and, you know, to at least get to know people, even if it isn't as much, you know, spreading the gospel, but at least getting to know people and let people know that people are caring about them.
Yes, yes. There is there's a Lutheran pastor, Nadia Boltz-Weber is her name, and she shared something on her blog this week that I thought that was just very applicable to this. She talks about how when we can focus our heart, it can bring clarity and freedom, which is, you know, the heart on target. You know, she says it stops us from asking, have I done enough or have I given enough? You know, we can always ask that question. And those are not freeing questions. Those always makes us feel, you know, more guilty. You know, we just always feel like we haven't done enough. And so she says, instead of asking, have I done enough or have I given enough? She said, ask, you know, what is mine to actually do and what is mine not to actually do? So what she's saying is that there are some things in our lives that are our responsibility, that we need to take ownership up and do that. But then there are some other things that actually need to be done in this world, but they're not really our responsibility. And so we just need to give ourselves freedom to say, you know what? Yes, that needs to be done, but that is not my responsibility to do that. So, and by doing that, it just gives us clarity and it gives us freedom to say, okay, this is what my responsibility is. And so let me focus on this. Yes, there's a lot more other things that need to be done, but that's, you know, not actually not my responsibility. So she says we cannot and should not try to do everything because then we become very ineffective. That's very, very true. I can tell you one of the ways that this played out in my own life is when coronavirus hit and we had to close the church and we couldn't meet on a regular basis. And we tried to figure out a way that we could stay connected to one another. And my first thought is, well, I need to try to reach out to every single member of our church every week. And I realized, you know, I would love to do that, but that's really not feasible, especially when we were videotaping every single worship service and every single worship service had to be edited and then, you know, produced and then all of that stuff. And so I gave myself permission to say, you know what, Craig, this is really not your responsibility to do that, but it is your responsibility to find a way to allow our congregation members to stay connected. And so this is when we came up with the idea of the directory. If you remember, everyone on your page of the directory, you were supposed to reach out to. And by doing that, it gave this new clarity to all of our congregation members. You know, we all felt, you know, we just can't do everything that we want to do anymore. So what are we to do? Well, then this gave us direction by saying, well, I can't maybe reach out to every single member, but I can reach out to these 10 or 12 other families on the list, and I can do that well, and that will be meaningful, not only to me, but to the other people. So it gives your life purpose when you can clarify, you know, what is my actual responsibility? Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So how many of you ever get caught in that feeling that you have to do everything and do it well? Do any of you? Yes. You know, we get caught up in that, right? And then we end up doing really nothing well, and we end up feeling guilty for not doing everything. It's just this vicious cycle. But to step back and to say, you know, as she asked, you know, what is actually mine to do and what is not mine to do, and give yourself permission to do the things that are actually your responsibility, do those well. And then the other things just release. And, you know, you can say a prayer saying, Lord, all those other things that really aren't my responsibility, you know, help someone else pick up those pieces so that everyone can be cared for, that everyone can be loved. It just gives yourself permission. And I think it's a better understanding of who we are called to be as God's people. St. Paul said that, you know, he tried to be all things to all people. And he said he did that terribly because he just couldn't do that. You know, he says when he was among Gentiles, he tried to reach out to the Gentiles. When he was among Jews, he tried to be the person that he needed to be to reach out to the Jews. So he gave himself permission just to do that, which God had called him to do in that moment, in that time, and then just released everything else into God's care. Make sense? mm-hmm. so easy to talk about. It's wise information, but it's hard to live out, I think, especially when everything seems out of control in our lives and we feel like we have to do everything. Okay, as I shared before everyone got on, this next question is for Chet and Peg. I thought of them right away. It says, what is the one project, effort, or dream about which you would most like to be able to say it is finished? And what is that? Their new house, right?
Yeah. I would say planning ahead and the future.
Yes.
Is finished.
Yes. Yes, I think we're all going to celebrate with you when you can finally say it is finished.
We'll get a case of champagne and bring it to church and we'll have it.
There you go. No one would, everyone would love that, that's for sure. So, yeah. So what other things would you like to be able to say it is finished where you can't quite yet? Yes, Wayne.
This one isn't necessarily something that for me to do the whole thing, but I try to do my part, because I'd love to be able to say we have peace in the world, and while we can, disagree, that we can agree to disagree without being in fights all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
I think that one's got to take a lot of intervention from the man upstairs.
Yes. The scientists have pretty much told us that coronavirus is going to be around, forever. Not like it is now, but we'll learn better to deal with it. But, I think that's on everyone's heart. So we just wish that all of this could, we could just say it is finished. Even though, especially when we see the graph of the local cases, starting to rise exponentially again, I think deep down in our hearts, we're tired of this. We're, we just want it over. So I think that is, that's one thing that we would like to say it is finished for. And, I know how I feel, but I can't imagine how the medical staff, of all they went through, and then finally, with the vaccinations, the numbers started decreasing, and with summer, but now that winter, fall and winter is upon us, they know what's coming. And so you can just imagine what they're going through and the prayers of support and courage that we need to offer for them. So I can't imagine being in their shoes right now. Yes, Marcia.
And that has posed another problem for the medical community. Baylor Scott & White has mandated that as of October 1st, everyone who works in their hospitals will be vaccinated. Not everybody is choosing that path.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them are leaving their jobs because they feel that strongly about being vaccinated. So that leaves gaping holes in care for patients. Nurses are leaving, case managers are leaving. And yet more and more people are filling up those hospital beds to bursting.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Good point.
So if you're going to pray for the medical community, they will need it.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So let's go on. Let's see on page 76. The second scripture reading is from 2 Timothy 4. It says, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. So the reflection questions are, how would you describe the fight or the race that your life represents? So when you hear those words, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, what comes to mind? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, Chet.
I recorded trying to be a good provider and a good neighbor.
Okay, yes. Yeah. Yeah, when I think about, I finished the race, I always think of the race as not a sprint, but as a marathon, that faith is day by day, one step in front of the other. You know, sometimes having to climb that hill on that long race, or you know, not knowing what's around the next corner, and yet just, you know, trying to continue to run. That's what comes to mind for me when, you know, he talks about I have finished the race. And maybe, you know, I have fought the good fight, just maybe to remind ourselves that, you know, to never give up, that, you know, we just continue to fight, continue to press forward, even when we don't know how. So, so what else comes to your mind when you talk about how would you describe the fight or the race that your life represents? Yes, Linda.
Mine's probably what everybody else's is, or maybe I could be reading this totally wrong. It's trying to help the kids, my sons and grandsons. And that's kind of where my total focus, my major focus is.
Yes. And that's a great focus, indeed.
They don't always think so, probably. Although I do not ever try to give advice to the sons. They're past that. The grandsons, yes.
Good for you. Yeah. So, and then at the top of page 77, it says, when you read the phrase, laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord will give to me, what kind of anticipation do you feel? You know, the thing that jumps out at me for this, you know, the language where it says, laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord will give to me. That's total grace language, right? That's, you know, that God has laid up for me. That is God as the actor, and which the Lord will give to me. That is pure gift. That is pure grace. So that, you know, the fact that he is laying up for me and he's giving to me, you know, that's knowing that that God's grace is active in my life. You know, no matter what is to come, knowing that God's grace, it's, you know, is active, it's going to be okay. And that brings forth, I think, a sense of gratitude in my heart to know that it's all gift and that God is active in my life. So, anyone else? Yes, Wayne.
I agree with the gratitude, but I also temper it with the feeling that I'm not worthy of that gift.
Yes. Yeah. So, and I think we all wrestle with that. So let's talk about that briefly. So when we don't feel worthy of God's grace and God's love, how do we get past that? I know we've all been there for before. What can we do to get past that? Yes, Wade.
For me, it's, you know, kinds of trying to constantly through the day be praying and, you know, asking, you know, keep guiding me to be the person you want me to be.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, we're bombarded with lots of voices, the voices from outside, you know, from other people, from the world. You know, the news is constantly bombarding us with voices, you know, the voice in our own head, all that negative self-talk, as some people call it, you know, all of those voices try to define who we are, but we have to find a way to listen to the voice of God and to listen to what he says we are. You know, like, you are my child, you are my beloved child, and nothing can ever separate you from my love. You know, we have all of these promises that we've been dealing with during the summer months. And I think it's to be able to hone in on that voice of God over all of the other voices, especially the voice inside of our own head, to recognize that none of those other voices truly define who we are. It's the voice of God that fully defines who we are. So we can, you know, we can do the most awful thing. We can make the most awful mistake. And yet we are still the beloved of God, and that God still has plans for us, that God still can use us as broken as we are. You know, that's, I think, how we get out of that rut of not feeling worthy of God's love, is just to recenter our lives on what God has said about us. And we do that, of course, through the word, right? When we can no longer hear God speaking to us, when we can no longer hear God's voice over all of the other voices, then we need to go back to God's word. We need to, you know, center our lives, to set aside some quiet time just to listen for God's voice. You know, if you want to hear God talk to you, you go to the Bible, right? That's the way we hear God talk to us. And it's not only through the words on the page, but sometimes it's the quiet meditation after that, or maybe throughout the day for a passage that you read. And then all of a sudden we start hearing that still small voice of God speak to us. And it brings hope. It brings renewed passion and purpose to our lives. Anyone else? So thank y'all for the conversation tonight. So why don't we close with prayer? Oh Lord, when we veer off track, when we get distracted, grant us once again focused hearts. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
So thank you all for being here. We hope to see you again next week. Invite a friend to join us. So have a great week. God bless. Mm-hmm.